Lord of brights and abiding light, you have shown us, in the person of Jesus your Son, a new way to live. You have poured your light into the world and have asked us to live in the light rather than run and hide in the darkness of doubt and despair. You promise to be our lights all of our days and ask us to place our complete trust in you. The journey in this light is risky. It means that we will have to be very serious about our service to you, giving you our uttermost best and offering hope and light to others. Let us be in prayer with one another, for our church and our community, for our nation and our world, for all Earth's peoples and creatures, that we may be those who promote peace and love. Give us the courage and the strength. Help us to reach across areas that divide, offering compassionate assistance wherever it is needed. In this last Sunday of the year, we bring to you, O God, the names and situations of others for whom the light seems to be a stranger. They struggle with ill health, economic hardships, broken and damaged relationships, loss of loved ones, and anxiety. We place them into your care. Let your light shine on them, bringing healing and hope and restoration. Help us to be bearers of this light in all that we do, O Lord. Bless each one of us in your service, for we ask this name in the mighty name of Jesus, who has taught us the prayer when we come together to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
God. Our epistle reading today comes from Galatians chapter 4, verses 4 through 7. But when the fullness of time had come, God sent his Son, born of a woman, born under the law, in order to redeem those who were under the law, so that we might receive adoption as children. And because you are children, God has sent the Spirit of his Son into our hearts, crying, Abba, Father. So you are no longer a slave, but a child. And if a child, then also an heir through God. May God add a blessing to the reading of his holy word. Amen.
If I were to say to you bacon, you'd say eggs. If I were to say ladies, you'd say gentlemen. If I were to say hammer, nail, shoes, socks, peanut butter, jelly. There are just some words that go together. Paul, in his letter to the Galatians, uses two words that don't seem to go together at all: law and adoption. I suppose there is a law that prevents you from claiming a child as your own. There are procedures to follow and rules, the process for adoption. But other than that, I'm not sure there's much of a connection between law and adoption. Law conjures up words like obedience, punishment, must, shall, do, don't. Adoption conjures up words like family, mother, father, baby, belonging, love. Paul uses the word child, but when he's talking about the law, he uses the word slave. Slave is not a child. A strange thing happened to my daughters as they grew up. They became me, taking on some of my quirks and tendencies and habits. When they were little, I had rules that they had to clean their room and write thank you notes after birthdays and Christmases. That's just what you did. That was the rule. If you got a gift, you wrote a thank you note. If you had a room, you took care of it. Now, as adults, my daughters have clean houses and they write thank you notes. I'm pretty sure that it's not because I hold any kind of parental authority over their lives now. They are 28 and 30 years old. But I think it's because those rules created for them a sense of responsibility and order that they found to be good. I think those rules fostered in them relationships and a sense of gratitude. I suppose it's not surprising that my daughters became like me. I became like my mother. Well, my father too, actually. When I was young, my parents made me go to church. They made me go to Sunday school. I didn't always want to. And yet, by making me do those things, following those rules, I had a community that was nurtured for me, that I belonged to as I matured. Those rules nurtured for me an understanding of mystery and love within a faith tradition that grew to become and is still my home. I wonder if Mary's parents made her follow the rules, you know, maybe write thank you notes after her bat mitzvah, or clean a room before the Sabbath, read the Torah, consider the prophets, say her prayers. She had to have obeyed some rules, some laws, in order to create the space that allowed her to receive God as she did. And those rules would have nurtured within her the hope about which she sang in the Magnificat. I guess that's the connection between law and adoption. Follow the rules, and in doing so, something is created in you that changes you, That's a big shift. It's a shift from doing something because you're told to do something and doing something because you want to. It's a shift between acting out of fear and responding because of love. It's a shift between obeying and belonging. It's a shift from a slave to a child. That shift doesn't happen overnight. It sometimes takes years in the fullness of time. But no such shift is needed on God's part. There was never a time when I didn't fiercely love my daughters, even as I made them follow the rules. And God has always fiercely loved us. God has said through the prophets, I have written your name on the palm of my hand. The angel told Mary, do not be afraid. Jesus told his disciples, what greater love is there? And Paul wrote to the church, you are God's children. New Year's is the time where we make resolutions. You know, set those goals, name those things that we know we should probably do in order to become the people we want to become, and yet somehow haven't quite managed to do so. Maybe this year, as you consider your goals for the coming year, you might think about finding the things you should do in order to nurture the realization of the fact that you are God's child. It's the difference between law and adoption. For many, it's the difference between life and death. And I'm quite sure it's the difference between the kingdom of God in heaven and on earth. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Oh, great God of grace, in this moment before we can receive your grace, we must confess that we do not come before you having earned your favor by our good actions. We confess that we've not loved our enemies. We confess that we've not forgiven fully those who feel wronged by us. We confess that we think more about our own needs than the needs of others, especially those less fortunate than us. Trusting in your love, we come before you now in silent confession, to lift to you the burdens of our hearts. Hear now these words of assurance. Through the unconditional love of God in the person of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. We are forgiven. Thanks be to God.
Thank you. As you leave this service, know that you've been affirmed and blessed by God unconditionally. And being so loved, as you go about your week, make an intentional effort to affirm and bless those you encounter. May we spread this great love and joy that we have received. In the name of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.